this conference for giving me an opportunity to share my perspectives about making organizations or treating organizations as living systems. So thanks for the introduction. As you mentioned, I am principal consultant at ThoughtWorks. Been there for close to 8 years, and I have helped teams, leaders, organizations improve agility and work with organizations of all sizes and types across the globe. And as you mentioned, this is the cover of my book that's coming out. That's going to be released sometime towards the end of June. So look forward to getting that out and sharing some perspective about agility on at the enterprise level through that book with all of you. All right, before I begin, I want a confession to make. What I'm going to talk about is based on complexity science. And I have drawn parallels from complexity science to check or to see what it means for organizations. And complexity science is based on a lot of underlying sciences like physics, chemistry, sociology, psychology, etc. So while my expertise is in understanding organizations and how people work and how leaders enable organizations, my expertise is not in the underlying sciences, which are below the complexity science. So that's the confession which I want to make. We did not do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. Does anyone know who this person is?
Absolutely. Nokia.
Absolutely. You guys are a well-educated, well-aware, enlightened audience. Yes. This person is Stephen Ellop, ex-CEO of Nokia. And he said these words at the time when he was handing over Nokia to Microsoft with tears in his eyes. Just having seen this company lose valuation so swiftly from being the number one leader to, finally got it into a position where it had to be sold off because it lost so much value. What do you think went wrong with Nokia? Anyone? Innovation was less, okay.
Respond to change.
What do we mean by respond to change? What did they not respond to?
They didn't understand the customer.
They didn't predict the future properly. The future was changing quite dramatically, and that was the time when they are supposed to switch. It requires an immediate switch.
Yeah.
Probably they delayed. They did the switch, but by that time it was very late.
And we also didn't understand their competitors. Learn their competitors and how they are actually doing in markets and all those stuff. So
they became complacent with their market leadership.
Yes.
Right? And then Apple came, with this iPhone, and you could add apps, etc. to that, and it changed the entire experience and journey for the user in terms of how you use the cell phone, right? And they just lost leadership. So I think this sentence is significant because he believes we did not do anything wrong. I think, yes, they did, obviously did something wrong, otherwise they wouldn't get it to where they landed up with finally, right? So I think not taking action or not responding to change does not mean that you will be there as is. Today, the forces in the environment are impacting you so much that even if you maintain status quo, that is actually doing something wrong. Agree?
Yeah.
Right. Next one, Kodak. What happened to Kodak?
Similar story,
taking market leadership for granted, ignoring the technological trends, right? Do you know who invented the digital camera? Yes. And they, to the information that's available with me, they didn't even file a patent for it. And they just kept ignoring the development which was happening there, and suddenly they lost market leadership. Whole way in which people started taking photographs changed. And these changes happened very, very swiftly. Right? So what's happening? Organizations are struggling to survive. Right? No organization today, regardless of their age or their size, can take their survival for granted. Organizations are losing valuations very, very fast. if you look at the top 10 brands about 10, 15 years ago, and if you look at the top brands or the top market valuations in the S&P 500 or anywhere else across the globe, the names are changing very, very fast, right? So you might be there, but the others have overtaken your valuations, or your valuations might have also lost. What's happening is the speed of change. And the struggle for organizations today is how to keep up, at least keep up with the pace of change which is happening in the external environment, if not exceed it. Organizations are dealing with unprecedented circumstances. And that's all happening because of technological disruptions. Earlier, organizations could decide to what extent they wanted to be exposed to the environment, and they could operate in a little bit of a vacuum and decide how much they wanted to be influenced by and influence the environment. Today, that's not the case. Some change happens in the environment, then your whole industry can get disrupted. Forget about an organization. Look at what Airbnb has done to the hospitality industry. Or look at what Uber is doing, or Ola, you know, is doing to the transportation industry. Who knows what blockchain is going to do to many industries? So the point is that today organizations are becoming an environment where they have no choice but, you know, to deal with the changes in the environment. What does that mean? It means that complexity is all around us in the business, and the complexity is increasing day by day. However, and this is my hypothesis, and this is really the underlying thread of my book which is coming out, is that complexity is not new to us. As humankind and as nature, we have dealt with complexity since time immemorial. Let's look at a few systems. Let's look at economies. Top left-hand corner. We began with barter system, right? Then we moved to paper money. Then we moved to credit money. And now, who knows, we might move to cryptocurrencies. What's happening is we are out. Look at human beings. We were apes. And then we evolved, and we are still evolving, and we evolved into multiple races, different shapes and sizes. Yes, the overall form is the same, but the evolution is still happening. Look at traffic. There were no cars earlier. There were modes of transportation based on animals. And now we are talking of cars, now we are talking of self-driving vehicles, and people are also talking now of sky taxis or sky vehicles. I think they are expected to come out in the next 10, 15 years. We look at jungles or forests. Again, based on my limited study, what I've read is that the trees which existed prior to the dinosaur era are not there anymore. It's a completely different set of trees which are now there in the jungles. How did the evolution happen? Right? It didn't happen one fine day, but it was constant evolution that happens. All these systems are categorized as complex adaptive systems. So all natural and socio-economic systems fall under this category. Let's try and understand this model on which these systems work. First of all, there are a few what are called as agents. So in our human body, cells are agents. In an organization, people are agents. In a marketplace, buyers and sellers are agents. In a jungle, trees are the agents, insects are the agents. These agents interact with each other. And based on the interaction of the agents is what emerges. So when we look at a stock market, it's when people buy and sell, right? They're interacting through the process of buying and selling. That's how the index emerges. You can't predict what that index is going to be today. Whether it's going to go up, whether it's going to go down, how much? No. It all has to emerge based on the interactions. and that leads to complex adaptive behavior. And there is constant feedback, you know, information going out into the environment that we take away from the environment. And again, based on that feedback, that positive feedback coming in, negative feedback coming in, the agents adjust their behavior. So this is how the model works in a complex adaptive system. Let's look at, you know, key characteristics based on this model. First, agents are largely autonomous. I use the word largely because there definitely have to be some rules. For example, if you take the situation of a traffic system, you are free to drive any vehicle you want. You are free to drive at any time you want. But obviously, if you're supposed to be driving on the left-hand side, you can't be driving on the right-hand side. Yeah? If you break that rule, it can be fatal. Similar is for people, say, who are participating in a stock market. You're free to buy anything, you're free to sell whatever you want. But obviously, that has to be within a set of rules. But there is a large amount of freedom which is given to the agents in terms of how and where they want. Agents' interactions influence the system behavior. Now, this is very, very important takeaway I think we have from a complex systems perspective. It is not just that the agents themselves add value, but the interaction between the agents is what creates value. Right? You took the example of buying and selling, you know, in a stock market, or even people interacting with each other. Like what is happening right now? We are all here to interact with each other, and we are deriving value from that interaction. So that is very important, is that value is not just agent-specific, or agent by itself cannot create that value, but a larger value is created when agents interact with each other. Third is coherence around purpose. So again, coming back to the stock market example, why do people go to the stock market? To maximize their wealth. That's the purpose why people are there. Look at us today at this conference. Why are we here today? We are here to learn, share, network. So any purpose which is there, right? And if people identify with that purpose, they will cohere around. They will gather around that purpose. They will connect around that purpose. Emergence. Just give an example of a stock market. You can't predict what's going to happen. Say when two people interact with each other. Say, I have a perspective, you have a perspective. And we interact, but we may end up with a third perspective, which we had not thought of before we got into the meeting. That is emergence. You can't predict. It's not linear. And the last but not the least, it's constant evolution. Always sensing what changes are happening in the environment and always evolving with those changes. So, the attribute, I think, which best enables organizations to embrace change is what? What do you think? What is that one attribute? What is this conference about?
Agility.
Sorry, I couldn't find a better picture to denote agility, but yeah, it's all about the ability to be flexible enough to adapt to change, right? And I think why, so agility again is a very generic term. If you want to bring it to life, what are some of the key characteristics of agility?
Flexible.
Yes.
Innovative
as well, yeah. What else?
Responding to changes.
Ready to change, yes. So I have identified these three. Ability to sense the environment. I have to be able to sense what's happening outside. Well in time. The ability to adapt. And the ability to respond. And the others are also very valid. And again, the definition of agility can be very specific to an organization or for a team, right? For someone, agility may mean stability. For someone, it may mean efficiency. But to me, these are three primary characteristics which any system would need. It's the ability to sense, the ability to respond, and the ability to act. Of course, sensing is first, but the other two, in which order do these two happen, that vary based on circumstances. And I think complex adaptive systems have all these three characteristics. Do you agree? Yes? So let's move on. So if we try to understand that complexity has always been there and that we have systems which have dealt with change since time immemorial, why are organizations struggling to deal with change? My premise is that organizations got modeled as mechanistic or closed-ended systems. So if you look at a machine is incapable of changing itself or adapting to the environment unless there is specific intervention done. And that again, there are limitations. You can't expand a machine just like that. You can't change its characters just like that. Machine which produces threads, you can't use that machine to produce cars. So when you model something as a machine, you are actually modeling it for predictability and stability. You are modeling it for a specific purpose. And when the need comes to change, the machine is incapable of changing. And I think my view, my hypothesis, that we have modeled organizations as machines or closed-ended systems. And therefore, they are difficult, they are finding it difficult to deal with change. And how do you break that? You have to remodel the enterprise. Move it from a mechanistic model to a CAS model, to a complex adaptive system. And if you want to do that, what are the implications for leaders of organizations is what I'm going to talk about. So here are some implications for leaders, and I'm presenting this in a similar structure as the Agile Manifesto, as you can see. VUCA over predictability and stability. Who knows what VUCA is?
Volatility,
uncertainty, perfect,
complexity,
perfect, absolutely right. Leaders need to embrace these things, which leaders are not used to. As I said, organizations were modeled for predictability and stability. So, does it mean predictability and stability are not important? Of course not, they are definitely important. But the point is that cannot be the primary objective of an organization. Predictability and stability, you have to let it emerge. So emergence again, and that really is the mindset change which is needed, is that you have to work on VUCA and leverage VUCA so that you are able to achieve predictability and stability for your enterprises and let it emerge and let it balance out. Second, guiding over directing. When we look at complex systems, at best you can guide them. How many of us have children here? You know, us? We all know we were also children at one point in time, and if we recall, you cannot direct even a 6-month-year-old baby or a 2-year-old child or any age child. You can only guide, but finally they will do what they have to do. Right? And that is true for any complex system. You can't even direct an animal to do something. Yeah. You have to just guide them. And I think that is the nature of leadership. To come into complex adaptive systems or living systems is that they have to steer something in the right direction. They cannot push it. Next one is effectiveness over efficiency. So again, if you look at our organization structures, the way we optimize for specializations, the way we have created silos, all of that is done with the primary objective of optimizing on efficiency. And when can you optimize on efficiency is when you do something in a very, very repetitive way. But today we are in a knowledge era. We are all doing creative type of work. we are dealing with unprecedented circumstances, and the nature of work and the way we need to respond to changes is changing very, very fast. When your survival is at stake, what is the point in having efficiency as the driver? It has to be effectiveness. You have to create value, and you have to be able to respond to change in a very effective way. Does that mean again that efficiency is not important? Of course it is. Or rather focusing on effectiveness does not mean that you allow waste to come into the system. So the point is that we have to focus on effectiveness. And when you have to trade off between effectiveness and efficiency, you have to trade off in favor of effectiveness. And I think that is what, you know, even our human body does. Suppose we are starving. It will start burning fat which is stored in the body. It will not preserve it just for the sake of efficiency. What is the objective there? Effectiveness, to survive. And that is really how every living system which has adapted to change has thrived and survived. It is based on how effective they are. Next one is about, and this is I'm talking specifically with respect to leaders, is tech awareness or technology awareness over technology indifference. And I'm saying this specifically from my experience when I'm working with leaders. So why technology? Because that is the most important factor today which is causing all the disruptions in the environment. Technology is dealing with, you know, the speed and the nature of disruptions. But you see so many organizations today in traditional industries where there is no technology representation at the board level. In fact, in many organizations, the CIO or the CTO reports to the chief financial officer or to the chief executive officer. I have had situations where businesses would not exist if there was no technology, like an online business. But when I have tried to speak to their board of directors in terms of making them understand how their technology department needs to become more adaptive, responsive to change, how they need to become more aware of the technology threats which are happening in the market, I have often got a response which is very poor. And I think if you want to be attuned to your environment as a leader, you need to be technology aware. Of course, you need not be technology expert. There are experts who are aware, but you need to be having conversations with them and see how you can leverage that expertise to ensure that, you know, you are able to adapt and respond to change. Next is about leveraging risk and avoidance. Again, the traditional mindset that leaders have is that if you see a risk, it has to be mitigated, it has to be killed as early as possible. Risk is only seen from a negative consequence perspective. Risk means something bad is going to happen or can happen. And therefore, the earlier you mitigate it, the better it is. Now the point is, unless you experiment and you innovate, you or your ability as an organization to respond to change will be very limited. And if you have to experiment, then if you have to innovate, you have to take risk. Now, how much risk can be taken? And can you contain that risk? I mean, the risk should not be so big that it brings down the entire organization with it, or an entire division with it. Obviously not. But can you take calculated risks? Can you take bets? Even if 8 or 9 bets fail, but that one bet becomes successful, pays off for the remaining now. And I think leaders need to be cognizant of how do they nurture those bets, how do they continue with the bet when they are getting an encouraging feedback, and how do they kill those bets when they realize that it is not working. I think that's the skill and that's the mindset which leaders will need to do. The next one is about systems thinking over reductionism. And this reductionism mindset again comes from a mechanistic model. It's like you have some parts, each part does it good, and you just assemble the parts together and the machine goes. If you look at a human being, right, we are not a sum of our body parts. We are much more than that. If you just add up the body parts, you will not get life into a human being. Same is the case for any complex system. As a system, its behavior is not a sum of the parts. And therefore, if you try to tackle a problem only by looking at a specific part of the system and try to fix that part without understanding the overall impact which it can create across the system, I think you're inviting trouble. For, you know, just to take an example, right? If an employee does something wrong and you take an extreme measure to fire that person, sure, if you take a reductionist approach, it's all about that one employee. But if you take a systems thinking approach, that one incident can impact the morale of the entire organization. And that is the property of a complex system, is that you have to look at anything that you do, what is the impact on the system? I have read up a case study where there was a hospital and they did a customer satisfaction survey. And they found that the customers were really not happy, they are grumpy. They said that, oh, from the time they enter the hospital, the receptionist is grumpy. And then once we get in, you know, we are more agitated. And the experience just became a vicious circle. The leaders of that hospital recognize that maybe there's one small change that they need which can make a difference. So they invested in training the front desk staff, the people at the reception who are greeting guests. And they made them to understand how friendliness is important, how they should be making the patients more comfortable, etc. With that one change, if you look at it from a reductionist perspective, it's just that small change related to the reception of the hospital. But the impact of that small change is huge. The customer satisfaction improved dramatically. You know, with that positive experience when, you know, patients entered the hospital and went past the reception stage, the whole thing started cascading into a positive feedback. So when I say it's about, you know, systems thinking, we should look at what are called as Lego parts in complex adaptive system terminology, which means that you introduce one small thing, but it can have a very big impact. And sometimes you introduce one big thing and it can have no impact at all. So here is where, you know, reductionism, you know, needs to be done away with, and systems thinking becomes very important. And I think as leaders, as managers, because of the siloed approach that we have taken, because of the functional specialization approach that we have taken, We have looked to only optimize part of the system, never looked at it as a system as a whole. We are not encouraged to do that. And I think we need to get over that mindset. Next one is emergence over upfront detailed planning. As we all know, I think the Agile Manifesto is pretty clear about this. Responding to change over following a plan. And what does Agile say? Plans are not important, but the process of planning is important. The implication is that when change is happening in the environment, which you can't control, even the organization changes in the ways in which sometimes you can't fully direct it. So upfront detailed planning is something which is not worth doing. It's actually a waste of time. And you have to build on emergence and act on that rather than say, I want the system to behave in this particular way. And adapt your plans to the emergent situation. This is again a characteristic which leaders find difficult to change to. Which is to say, I don't have all the answers. Let's find out the answer together. Right? Rather than say, I know everything, I am the boss, I get you to follow orders and you do it. So this is about, you know, leaders actually admitting their limitations, wanting to work with a team to say, we'll figure it out together. And I think this inclusive mindset, rather than, you know, a mindset which is like the alpha leader that we often see, I think that is important. Because why this is even more important is because leaders today, the way they are positioned at the level of the hierarchy, many of them are out of touch with what's exactly happening. Most of them get reports which are dressed up to please them. And they live in this cocoon, they live in this false illusion of certainty. And therefore that dominance comes in, they believe that they know, but they actually don't. And I think that's where it's important for them to get down to the ground level and say, alright, here's a new situation, we have not dealt with this before, let's figure it out together. Customers first over shareholders first. This is again a key point which I'm actually, as we speak, writing about in my book. What is the primary purpose of the organization? So this movement, you know, which started somewhere in the early 1980s, especially in America, and that then spread all over the world, it got so ingrained into executives and also into management education that primary purpose of an organization is to maximize shareholder wealth. Now that is such a purpose which is so narrow, focusing on well-being of only one set of stakeholders. How absurd is it, right? I mean, it's almost like saying, if somebody is becoming a doctor, your primary real purpose, true purpose, is to serve people, to heal people. It's like saying a person became a doctor because their primary purpose is to make money. I think organizations today need to recognize that they exist because of their customers. And I think that's always a factor. But if you look at the other way around, where organizations have put shareholders first, at, you know, even before customers, you see these organizations not treating their customers well, just to maximize shareholder wealth, just to maximize the share price, just to take short-term decisions which may not be to the benefit of the customers, but to ensure that they are reporting sales and profit growth quarter by quarter. Their jobs are aligned based on that. Their bonuses are linked to how much the share price is increasing. And I think the point is, organizations need to move from that mindset, because today's customer is very, very knowledgeable. He's not the customer of the past. In the Industrial Revolution, what happened was the customer took anything which was thrown at him or her. Anything that got produced got consumed. Today, that's not the case. Today, yes? Exactly. Customers are networked today, they are well informed. Right? You have reviews. So the buying journey again is not linear. And customers are willing to change loyalty today at a drop of a hat for a better experience. My submission is, why do we see customers sitting on the other side of the table? Why can't we treat the customer as part of the overall ecosystem, which has a group of stakeholders around the enterprise? Why can't we treat the customer as part of our ecosystem and not somebody who's sitting on the other side of the table and someone seen as someone to be made money off of? Yes, of course, you need to make money, but that cannot be your primary objective if you focus on delighting your customer on email.
Amazon is the best example.
Absolutely.
So, Sunil, though I'm late in the session, just want to say that probably David Rogers, right, who is the dean at the Columbia Business School,
right,
and he has his own book, right, Transformation, the playbook, right, and that's where he talks about the five domains, and one of the domains he says, customer is a network. And he says that, you know, the moment you don't consider customer in your ecosystem, definitely you are making a product or a services for nobody.
Exactly. Exactly. That feedback loop, and essentially, you know, moving from customer as a resource to make money off of versus making sure that the customer's interest will lead to the better interest of everyone in the ecosystem. It's a huge mind change. I think that has to happen. Following on that, right? Engage versus exploit. The mindset of the leaders is to exploit. How does exploitation happen? Bullying at work, canceling somebody's vacation at the last minute. So why exploitation? How many times we have seen organizations which delay their payments to their suppliers? Purposely. That's exploitation. So when you know you are looking at it from a transactional perspective for your benefit only, why should they care about you? I mean, I know of a large organization, a big business conglomerate in India, their reputation is that they will not pay you the last payment. What is the supplier going to do? They will price it in into the other payments. There are suppliers I know who say, ऐसी हालत बना रखी है साहब कि ना जीने देते हैं ना मरने देते हैं. And the same exploitation mindset is towards employees, towards customers, towards the suppliers.
The same thing is applicable to one of the top Indian IT company behaving in US with the contractors, local contractors, not giving payments, not delivering payments for 6 months.
See, I think the point is organizations will go through difficulties. But can we work together to find a way out of it? Yeah, how can we be inclusive towards creating value for everyone in the ecosystem? And that can happen only when you engage rather than have a mindset of exploitation. That's a huge mindset change in mind.
Brother, all these things are not related with the cultural changes within the organization or probably inside a human being. Is it more linked to us, that particular thing? I think cultural change is more required.
They are, and also how people are rewarded. What does success mean? Right, that is important. And again, the mindset change, I'm here speaking of leaders. But even the shareholders will need to change their mindset. So somebody gave an example, I'm not sure if this is Simon Sinek or who said that there's this organization which never fires its people. The example which he gave is this. Suppose your child gets a poor grade, will you sack him or her from the house? No, right? That is how you have to deal with it, people. You have to engage. You have to find a way out. And there are organizations which have said, right, we are going through trouble. Is everybody willing to take a pay cut? Right? We'll not sack anyone. And people have done that. I have been a part of that organization when I moved into the IT industry, which faced that situation in 2001. And the decision was taken by all of us to take a pay cut rather than sack anyone in the company. And they recovered from that. That's engagement. All right. In the interest of time, I'm moving on. Of course, we can continue. Post this. So this is really some of the things which I thought I think leaders need to make this mind shift change in order to bring life into organizations. Okay. So as I said, we have modeled organizations as machines for predictability, for stability, not treating it as a living system but as a closed-ended system. That is obviously not going to help organizations. Organizations have life. People have life, and people bring that life into organizations. It's a living thing. It's not a dead entity. It's not something which is closed-ended. And we need to look at organizations as a whole and not just as a sum of its parts. And I want to end with a quote.